Are you also as bored as I am? You've probably also went through a whole array of challenging gaming experiences up till this point. From no-hitting your most hated Soulsborne bosses, to crawling back from a massive deficit to pull off an incredible comeback in a hyper-competitive, mechanically demanding multiplayer game, to perhaps increasing the base difficulty of your favorite games by turning to more extreme challenges. But that's never enough. Of course not. Games are made to be played by as many as possible, so naturally they need to cater to those needs, both of the players and of the developers. Those damned cold gremlins do have families to feed, so they can't have players giving up because the games are too difficult. On an unrelated note, I made a game that can only be played once. As I was navigating the high seas, I noticed my online identity was being carefully reflected by the websites I was visiting, without even creating accounts for them. And sure, by this point probably everyone knows about cookies, at least concerning the fact that they store information about you, the user. But digging into the matter more, I came across quite a few more ingenious methods of keeping track of people online, so to speak, and thought it would be quite interesting to play around with them, maybe clarify stuff for both me and you, about how our online identities are created, tracked, and passed around by whoever may be interested in them. However, by itself the subject is not that interesting, or at least has that big of a mainstream appeal, let's be real now. So, to satisfy your dopamine-addicted brains, I thought I'd raise a challenge, for both the project itself and you, the viewer. Now, considering I've talked about web-related stuff up till this point, you probably figured out the game was going to be one played in your browser. And you'd think that the next logical step would be to look into how to make such a game, preferably using a well-established framework. The thing is, I already had a really great game lying around. And by great, I mean absolutely atrocious. The thing is basically a shitty Flappy Bird clone I made using assets from the Dino game. You know, the one that shows up in your Chrome browser when you're offline. But hey, it works. I think. I didn't really stick around enough to test it properly. But I guess if it's bad enough, that makes it more difficult. So, still a win in my book. Anyway, the problem with all of this is that the game was made for my Android phone, using Jetpack Compose, because I wanted to get more familiar with it at the time. But, as you might know, as it is, Jetpack Compose by itself and Android apps in general don't pair well with browser without quite a bit of work, mainly of porting them to something that can actually be run inside of a browser window. And because I didn't want to port my already existing beautiful codebase, I looked around and came across Compose Multiplatform while researching how well Kotlin and WebAssembly play together. I'm not going to delve too deep into this, as it's not really the point of the video, but I figured I'd highlight some interesting things about these tools, considering I haven't seen that many people talk about them yet. So, setting up the project and adding my game was as easy as using an online tool to generate the boilerplate I need and then dropping the existing code where I wanted it to be. The project structure is really clean and well standardized. You have modules for each platform on which you want to deploy your app, with the center of attention being the common main module, where you generally spend most of your time, as it's the part that will be present in all modules once built. What I found really cool, and what helped me stay away from duplicate or boilerplate code much more than with other frameworks, is a really clean inbuilt dependency injection mechanism. You basically declare your required interfaces, functions, classes, objects, enums, annotations in your common module, add a expect qualifier to them, and then write their platform-dependent implementations in the corresponding modules with an actual keyword next to them. Taking these things into consideration, this whole game side of things was done quickly enough, and I could move on to the meaty part of the project. First off, working on the backend. I only needed a single model to be stored, that of the user, containing no more than 5 fields, one for the database ID, 2 for the name, respectively score of the player, and finally the stars of the show, one for the primary identifier and one for the fingerprint. Now, these last two may sound a bit confusing without any other context, but bear with me. I'll explain them later on. For now, just know that the primary identifier is what is used as the first check, and if others exist with the same value, it falls back on the fingerprint. And well, if that also fails, it's a sign I have to improve my methods. Next, I created 4 routes, for creating a user, updating one, checking if it already exists, and one to retrieve a list of all the users. to understand how I went about implementing these endpoints and integrating them with the app, let's talk about the flow of how a user interacts with the website. Because I want to be a good developer and neither start the game as the page loads, nor force the player to start the first time they open the page. The entry for the current user is created the moment the player presses the game screen to start. After that moment, whatever action the user takes can't cancel the start of the game, so even if they refresh the page, close the browser and so on, the entry exists, without any other input from them. So, the user creation endpoint must take whatever information one can gather to identify someone, and it must be done fast. No time for costly computations, which, spoiler alert, fingerprinting is just that, and fill in the blanks for fields that are necessary but the user hasn't provided information for yet. So, a random temporary username is generated, the score is set as 0, the fingerprint field is left empty, and for the primary identifier, a hash is generated based on the IP address of the request, accounting for the case in which the original client request is forwarded a number of times by checking the X_forwarded_4 header, if present. Now, the user entry is created, and the player just finished their game. They are now greeted with a form to input their username, which is then sent to the backend along with the score, to have the associated user entry updated. Once that's successful, the user is faced with the global leaderboard screen, which is basically the list of users ordered by their scores. Additionally, the update endpoint needs to also let the fingerprint be set for the current user. This fingerprint stuff starts once the user first opens the page if a current user profile hasn't already been generated, as it's by far the costliest part of the whole identification process. It's done in a separate thread or web worker to ensure it doesn't interfere with the user experience. Once the fingerprint is generated, it must either be sent to the update user endpoint, if the current user has already been created, or stored and sent with the create user request, if that wasn't sent by that point. And finally, the endpoint to check a user exists must also quickly return a response without much time to waste on calculations, as it's the first thing called each time someone opens the web page. What I found to be the most reliable source of information regarding the current user's identity is a combination of both the information inherently sent with the request, namely the IP address, which can be compared with that of the existing entries, as well as data stored on the user's device, such as in the local storage as well as in cookies. The second part also implies the fact that successful requests to the backend must also reinforce the identity of the user. So, when creating, updating, checking the existence of someone, the server also sends back a secure cookie to the frontend, so that it is not accessible by the local machine, but it is sent back to the backend along with every request. Additionally, when receiving information about the current user, I also made it so that the web app stores it in the browser. You may have realized by now that these are not all surefire methods. Maybe someone uses a VPN to change their IP address, or goes and clears their browser storage with every use. But the thing with tracking on the web is that it does not have to be 100% accurate. Rather, just be reliable enough so that a majority of the users don't bother to mess around with it, which is usually done by abusing the concept of friction, meaning increasing the number of steps a user needs to take to complete an action as much as possible. In this case, the action is wiping their web identity, and the steps are represented by the multitude of ways the gathered identification information is stored or extracted from them. I can guarantee most of you would give up sooner or later if a website that was creating anonymous profiles of you, which you visited often, required a lengthy enough process of removing your information from it. Now, for the final piece of the puzzle, your fingerprints. But first, I'll answer a simple question. Why not just use the IP address and call it a day? Well, here's the thing. There's a bit of a famous problem regarding these addresses, very suggestively named IPv4 address exhaustion. Originally, internet architecture had fewer than 4.3 billion addresses available, which, if you take a second to count just the devices around you, quickly raises a few warning signals in your brain. And that's what other people realized too, and decided to create a successor for IPv4, namely IPv6. Problem is, these protocols need to exist simultaneously. You can't just pluck the IPv4 protocol out of the wild at this point. Many older devices and networks rely solely on IPv4, especially in regions and networks where IPv6 adoption is low. And to combat this, ISPs resorted to using carrier-grade NAT, also known as large-scale NAT. The CGNAT network mechanism goes as follows. ISPs assign a single public IPv4 address to multiple end users, for example households or businesses. These users are then assigned private IPv4 addresses within their local networks. CGNet then translates private IPv4 addresses to the shared public IPv4 address, maintaining a mapping of private to public address translations, along with port numbers, to route traffic correctly between the internet and the individual users. Now, the problem is that only the public address is visible to a remote service. So, regardless of the device, they are treated as the same one if part of the same network. Hence the need to have a separate identification method if the first check fails. Which brings the focus back to fingerprinting. Browser fingerprinting is a set of tools and techniques used to identify and track users across the web, based on the unique combination of information that their browsers and devices reveal, like a user's operating system, browser type, screen resolution, time zone, keyboard layout, and so many more. Unlike cookies or other storage-based tracking methods, browser fingerprinting works passively by analyzing data provided by the browser during normal interactions with websites, and thus cannot be concealed, tampered with, or straight up deleted. There's a whole lot of these techniques, and the more you stack together, the more accurate the fingerprint becomes. And the best part is, it remains consistent across different browsing sessions. You have stuff like canvas fingerprinting, where an HTML canvas element is used to identify variances in a user's graphic drivers or GPU. The main idea is that a script draws an image, often overlaid with text. Naturally, every device with different hardware and drivers will render the image slightly differently, distorting its color and shape. A hash is then computed using the rendered image's data, which serves as the canvas fingerprint. An advanced form of this one is called WebGL fingerprinting, where instead of simple shapes, you render complex 3D graphics using WebGL. By the way, these graphics are drawn off-screen, the user never actually sees any of this. And this applies to every other technique. You generally never even know such a thing was happening. There's also font fingerprinting, where you check a user's unique set of fonts installed on their device. At the network level, you also have stuff like TLS fingerprinting, which is concerned with how a client, meaning you, and the server, meaning the web page you're accessing, do the handshake step of the TLS protocol, which, without delving too deep into it, is the first step done when establishing a connection over TLS, where both the client and the server do an exchange of specific information that allows them to assert that the other one is who they're claiming to be, just like a handshake. Another worth mentioning is audio fingerprinting, which follows subtle differences in how a device's software and hardware render audio content. When a sound is played on a device, factors such as the browser vendor and version, along with the CPU architecture, influence the exact way sound waves are generated and processed. These minute variations can be captured through a digital oscillator and analyzed to create a unique audio fingerprint of the device. I chose the three I found most interesting to implement, namely canvas, font, and audio fingerprinting. WebGL I found to generally be a bit unsuited for some devices, whether it being unsupported or too demanding. As for TLS, I looked into it a bit and found out that surprisingly it's less reliable than most of the other techniques and only is used in bulk with a large collection of other methods. The results of each were hashed, then combined, then hashed again, and then submitted to the backend once they were ready. And I made sure to test that the results were consistent, breathing a sigh of relief when that was confirmed. Not because I thought it wouldn't work, of course not. It was because the work was pretty much done. Now I can go and enjoy the thrill of playing a well-crafted, one-of-a-kind, extremely challenging gaming experience without a care for the implications of what I uncovered while working on this project. And if you appreciate the knowledge I cursed you with, you could also go and enjoy the thrill of clicking those like and subscribe buttons.